Welcome to Curt Landry Ministries.
Because we're going to go through some major world changes here in the next 7 years. And if you will adapt yourself to the fact that you are going to prosper in Him, because the kingdom goes from glory to glory, faith to faith. There's mass changes coming, and it's an opportunity for you to answer the call in your life and to prosper. When things remain status quo, as they've done the last 20 years, it's very hard to make great leaps in prosperity, because when things aren't shifting, there's no opportunity for the transfer of wealth. We need to understand these principles, and I'm teaching out of the New Testament, but these are Old Testament principles. If you're going to get an inheritance, the inheritance is coming to you because a family member passed away and left you an inheritance. That's why the word says, honor your father and mother. How can you receive an inheritance when you curse your mother and father? Well, in the spirit realm, that's why replacement theology and anti-Semitism is so bad, because all your family in spirit happens to be Jewish people. So when you're anti-Semitic, you've cursed your own family, and that's why you have no inheritance. But in John 10:1, it says, most assuredly I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. So what the Lord is saying, that in this hour, there is a way to get provision and finance, and it's through the narrow gate. The reason the Lord gives the instruction to tithe and offerings and first fruits and alms, all those are commandments of the Lord in order to prosper. They all come with instruction. The reason God gives you those instructions is because when you follow those instructions, you are entering through the gate. You are not climbing over the fence and robbing God's finances. Sons and daughters of the King come through the door, not over the wall. Generous is a state of mind. Generous is a kingdom principle. Amen. But the key and the difference in the third day is we have to be very careful that we are sowing our resources, our times, and our prayer into things that God has called us to sow our time and our resources in. I think the biggest shift from the second day to the third day, and the second day, it didn't seem to have as many consequences. I'm sharing with you. I didn't see it so much last year and the years past, but what I have observed, particularly since Passover, it is critically important, and I'm not trying to put you into bondage, but it is critically important that you hear from God and do exactly what God is saying to do, and not miss your opportunities. It seems like opportunities, let me say it this way. In a time of meditation, I was meditating on different people I know in different ministries, And I literally analyzed what I know about their lives and their ministry over the last 15 years. And I watched the ministries that are growing, and I watched the ministries that are remaining the same, and the ministries that are dying, and the ministries that are no more. And you want to know the key? That every time God had a moed, a divine appointment, the ones that prospered were in the right place at the right time. And the ones that are not, are suffering, were distracted by other appointments. And I'm just going through my own experience because I know these ministries well enough that I can say they weren't at this Passover, they weren't at this Tabernacles, and they weren't at that Yom Kippur. And because what's happening is there are blessings that happen in the spirit that are in a moed for those who are called to the moed. And as soon as they miss a moed, you'll watch their health and their finances and their relationships and their family start to deteriorate. And the reason is because of, is this okay? Can I go into this? The attack that was coming against them, which was coming anyway against their call, what happens is it's kind of like they don't have the bullets and the iron dome. They don't have the things necessary to thwart the attack of the enemy, because those blessings that they were to receive aren't in their gun. And so they're suffering unnecessarily. When you suffer unnecessarily, you usually will overreact to try to correct your position. When you overreact to correct your position, you draw fire from the enemy, because then you start blaming everything on the enemy. Then you'll start blaming it on leadership. You'll just, I'm not talking about you. I'm just saying this is hypothetical. But what happens is you start attracting spiritual warfare that was not, you were not anointed for, and that's why there's so many casualties. John Paul Jackson wrote, his last book that he wrote before he died was Unnecessary Casualties. It's a great book. And what he's talking about is what I'm talking about. I've watched Christians unnecessarily get into trouble spiritually because they're picking battles that they were never anointed to fight. And the reason Christians feel led to fight battles is because if they're insecure with their position, you're not getting this. Let's back into this scripture here, because I've got just a few minutes here. I've got 10 minutes, so I want you to really get. Let's go to Habakkuk 3:17. God gives you assignment, right? You've heard from God. The word of the Lord is confirmed with two or three prophets. You know it's God. We anoint you with oil. We lay hands on you. We put you under the tallit. It's Oklahoma. We roll you in egg and then in flour we fry you. The people from Joplin say they do that. In Oklahoma, we do it. If you come, we have the fry service. Not really, I'm joking. But we send you out. And there's a prophecy over you about how you're going to prosper, and everything you touch is going to prosper. All these things are good. And then all of a sudden, Habakkuk 3:17 comes, and your fig tree that you plant, there's no fruit on it. And you were called to be a farmer, and you were going to have a fig tree. And everybody saw you. In fact, you were a live stream. It was on television. And now here comes the critical people, and you're standing next to your tree, and it's like, and there's no blossom on it. And then all the family members come that, see, we told you it didn't work. Look at your almost dead fig tree. If you can't weather the critics, you're never getting to a harvest. And then, in addition to the fig tree, you had a backup plan with your little farm and your ministry. You plant some vines. And they follow after the stupid fig tree. No grapes for you. And then the same relatives come and say, well, I guess you can have Raisin Bran cereal. Because all your little grapes are shriveled up. But that's okay because you have a backup plan because you have olive oil. Except you have a leaf and you shake it and there's no olives. But it's okay because you have a backup plan there because you have some sheep. But they got cut off from the fold. But that's okay because you go into the barn. You had a backup plan there because you had a few stashed in there and then they're gone. Someone robbed your sheep out of the barn. So the guy that built the barn for you, boy, you sure don't know how to take care of your sheep. They're all gone. Went to your neighbor's house. Man, you have a great ministry. Everything you prophesied that was going to happen, not one thing happened. And you must go through that season of time where everything fails to be qualified in the kingdom of God and not jump over the wall and come through the gate. You have to be able to stand up and put your shoulders back and say, shut up. I don't care that my fig tree ain't blossoming. I don't care there's no olives. I don't care that all the sheep ditched me. There's none in the stall. I know one thing. God called me to be a farmer. And I'm going to stand in this barn and I'm going to let everything rejoice and I give praise for the Lord of my salvation because I'm not letting a tree or another tree or a vine or a couple of animals identify who I am in Him. Nobody has the right to label me but Him who paid for me. So you shut up. Because I'm too busy praising the Lord in the midst of this disaster. Because when the righteous praise, they're never forsaken and they won't be begging for bread. But most Christians don't make it through the secret that I'm going to share with you. Most Christians never make it to the next second chapter of their life. It's called the death of a promise. They get the word, they go, it dies. Well, must be sin in my life. I didn't work hard enough. I did this. I did that. The I's comes in. And then if you're married, it's the you's. And then it's the you. And then we fall off the mountain. We go down. And the whole time he was saying, I was just trying to make your feet like Ian's feet. I was just trying to get you to praise me even when you fail. I was trying to find a praiser who would praise me, who knows I'm not a man that I should lie. Amen. I'm just trying to get somebody who would praise me because even though it appears to have failed in 1 year, if you'll praise me, I'll pour out for the next 10. Amen. More than you could ever imagine. I'm just looking for a praiser, but The real gate is not just the ones that follow the instruction, because that's just legalism. It's the ones who will follow the instruction and praise me all the way through. Those who read Job and don't say, well, I'm Job. I always hear people hear that. I'm Job. You're not Job. I don't see any Job attitude on you. All you're doing is magnifying the suffering you're going through. Because Job said something. Job had this down. Job says, though he slay me, I will praise him. And what brought the release for Job is Job 42 and 10. It says, and when Job prayed for who? Shut up number one, shut up number two, shut up three, four, five, and six. When he lifted all the shut ups to the Lord, God restored him double. Let's stand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you just bow your heads, hope the Lord has spoken to you tonight. The Lord's looking for new wine, not whiners. The Lord is not looking for disciplined followers that say, no, I can do this. Where you're really angry and bitter inside and you follow the instructions, you just do it to get right with God. No, he's not looking for that. That's not what this is about. All these scriptures are about your identity. Your identity. See, the reason you focus on other people so much is because you don't know who you are. And you think, well, maybe if I do what they do, then maybe I'll get what they have. They appear to be in this small window of time, this small little window of their whole life, they're prospering. And then you look at that little 12-month, 48-month window, and you think, gosh, if I'll just reproduce that, I'll get that. That's foolishness. They've been on a journey, and they've been traveling a long way with the Lord for a long time. The Lord is calling a generation of people to have hinds feet. He called you here tonight because he wants to take you in the spirit up to a higher place on the mountain. And he's not asking for, yes, I will go. He's not interested in that. He knows you're going to say yes. He's asking for that scriptural prayer, Father, help thine unbelief. We need a blessing. We need an injection from the Lord in the area of unbelief. And it's not, am I speaking to those online right here? It's not, if you could get this. It's not unbelief that God can provide the $1 million, God can provide the relationship, God can open this. It's not. That's not the unbelief. The unbelief is this, is that God actually chose you out of all the people. He put his hand up on you. And it's hard because Your fig tree's not blossoming. Your olive tree has no olives. Your sheep are gone. And all the naysayers are really having a great time at your expense. And it takes a toll on your soul. That's why the psalmist said, "My soul finds rest in God alone. My peace I receive from Him." And in that place of quiet rest, He heals me from within. He pours on me His holy oil, the Spirit of the living God. That's what He's doing tonight. He's bringing your soul into a quiet place. He's comforting you. He says, "I know your fig tree didn't blossom the way you thought. I know that your olive tree didn't bring the oil you desired. I know what they're saying. I know what you're thinking. But what I want to hear from you tonight, the Lord is saying, my child, you are not my servant. You are not a farmer. You're not a vine dresser. You're not responsible for any of this, because you are my sons and my daughters. And as I said at the beginning of the service, I'm your king. I am in control of all things. And it's Jubilee. And I'm going to restore you. But I want to heal you tonight. I don't want your soul. I don't want any question. I want you just to raise your hands in this house. And if you're online, just raise your hands in this house. If you just say these words, say, "I surrender. It's not my fault. I have not failed. I'm going through process. That is God's way. That is higher than mine. But my Father in heaven, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, sent me a word tonight through His prophet that says, I'm going to finish, and I'm going to finish well. And like Job, though he slays me, I will praise him. Lord, I pray for all my friends who have persecuted, who have said it doesn't work like that. I bless all of them tonight in the name of Jesus. And I receive in this season the double portion that Job receives. And I thank you, Lord. My soul, my identity is intact tonight. My heart is circumcised. The blood of the lump, which is holy, flows through the branches. I am healed. I am free from all doubt and from all unbelief. I am willing to be willing, and I have no fear of change, because all change is good, because I am accepting the Lord of change. Father God, I may not appear like you now, but I decree by your name, when you return, we should all be like you. In Yeshua's name, we seal it.
In Matthew 28, it talks about going into all the world. And when I think about going into all the world today, the best way to do that is through the power of media. You see, the airways, the atmosphere, is a very important tool that we have in our arsenal here at House of David. And that tool is getting ready to expand, and we need your help. That's the reason why that we want to take just a few moments and share with you what we're going to be doing. In the Shabbat services that we have on Friday night, we're going to be editing those services down to a television broadcast of 28 minutes and 30 seconds. The purpose is to consolidate this time period so people get an understanding of who we are, but to compartmentalize and make it so that it's a ministry to those who are seekers. So we need your help. You can sow into this ministry and into this media ministry here at House of David through Curt Landry Media today. We'd like you to do it on a weekly, on a monthly, on an annual basis. But you can be a part of spreading the gospel. You can be a part of answering that call that Matthew 28 is talking about by going into all the worlds and into all the nations. Why are we going into all the world? Here's why. Because you see, we have a streaming opportunity that goes around the globe via the internet. And now we want to go on television, broadcast television. We need your help. Would you be willing to sow with us? Would you be willing to help us start and become a champion in this ministry? We believe if you will, that God will bless your ministry, your life, your family, 100-fold. We trust in His word. We believe in His promises. And thank you for joining us. God bless you, and Shalom.